Right. Shorthand dictation, 80 words per minute, 10 minutes speed, October 1962, 80 words, 10 minutes speed, 10 seconds, 5 seconds. Now write down. Fellow countrymen, the appointed day has come and India stands forth again after long slumber and struggle, awake, vital, free and independent. The past clings on to us still in some measure, and we have to do much before we redeem the pledges we have so often taken. Yet the turning point is past. History begins anew for us. The history which we shall live and act, and others will write about. It is a fateful moment for us in India, for all Asia, and for the world. A new star rises, the star of freedom in the East. A new hope comes into being. A vision long cherished materializes. May the star never set and the hope never betrayed. We rejoice in that freedom even though clouds surround us and many of our people are sorrow stricken and difficult problems encompass us. But freedom brings responsibilities and burdens, and we have to face them in the spirit of a free and disciplined people. On this day, our first thoughts go to the architect of this freedom, the father of our nation, who embodying the old spirit of India held aloft the torch of freedom and lighted up the darkness that surrounded us. We have often been unworthy followers of his and have strayed from his message, but not only we but succeeding generations will remember this message and bear the imprint in their hearts of this great son of India, magnificent in faith and strength and courage and humility. We shall never allow the torch of freedom to be blown out, however high the wind or stormy the tempest. Our next thoughts must be of the unknown volunteers and soldiers of freedom, who without praise or reward have served India even unto death. We think also of our brothers and sisters who have been cut off from us by political boundaries and who unhappily cannot share at present in the freedom that has come. They are of us and will remain of us. Whatever may happen and we shall be sharers in their good and ill fortune alike. The future beckons to us. Whither do we go and what shall be our endeavor? To bring freedom and opportunity to the common man, to the peasants and workers of India, to fight and end poverty and ignorance and disease, to build up a prosperous, democratic and progressive nation, and to create social, economic and political institutions which will ensure justice and fullness of life to every man and woman. We have hard work ahead. There is no resting for any one of us till we make all the people of India what destiny intended them to be. We are citizens of a great country on the verge of a bold advance, and we have to live up to that standard. All of us, to whatever religion we may belong, are equally children of India with equal rights, privileges and obligations. We cannot encourage communalism or narrow-mindedness, for no nation can be great whose people are narrow in thought or in action. To the nations and the peoples of the world, we send greetings and pledge ourselves to cooperate with them in furthering peace, freedom and democracy, and to India, our much loved motherland, the ancient, the eternal and the ever new, we pay our reverent homage and we bind ourselves afresh to her service. Dear sirs, we are in receipt of your kind letter of 1st May. It is indeed a matter of regret to us that our negligence has given you reason to complain. From what you have seen of us in the course of our long-standing business relations, you must have been convinced that we are ever mindful of the interests of our valued customers. It is our duty, therefore, to clear up the charge of negligence rightly brought against us by you. If only to remove the blot on the fair name of our firm. Our business manager, who is in sole charge of the Mufassil order department, has been absent for some time due to illness. During his absence, the work of this department has been entrusted to a new hand. As this is a particularly busy season, it is quite likely that some mistake might have occurred due to oversight. But we assure you that the negligence complained of was not deliberate. It was purely accidental, owing to circumstances over which we had no control. We would now request you to be good enough to send back the unapproved goods, debiting the cost of carriage to our account. If you would also kindly give us a list of the glassware which suffered breakage, we would be glad to replace the articles at our cost. Hoping to be excused for the inconvenience caused, yours very truly.